Hi, everybody. David Pineacker 01. Now we're going to go further with the Smoky God. And just so you can see, here's the playlist. Here's playlist with all the parts. Part 5 will come here next. And part 5 will come down here, of course. All right, let's get into reading right away here. Part 5, Among the Ice Packs. For the next 45 days, our time was employed in dodging icebergs and hunting channels. Indeed, had we been favored with a strong south wind and a small boat, I doubt that the story could have ever been given to the world. At last, there came a morning when my father said, "My son, I think we're able to see home. We are almost through the ice. See? The open water lies before us." However, there were a few icebergs that had floated far northward into the open water still ahead of us on either side, stretching away for many miles. Directly in front of us, by the compass, which had now righted itself due north, there was an open sea. "What a wonderful story we have to tell to the people of Stockholm," continued my father, while a look of pardonable elation lighted up his honest face. "And think of the gold nugget stowed away in the hold." I spoke kind words of praise to my father, not alone for his fortitude and endurance, but also for his courageous daring as a discoverer and for having made the voyage that now promised a successful end. I was grateful, too, that he had gathered the wealth of gold we were carrying home. While congratulating ourselves on the goodly supply of provisions and water we still had on hand and on the dangers we had escaped, we were startled by hearing the most terrific explosion caused by the tearing apart of a huge mountain of ice. It was a deafening roar, like the firing of a thousand cannon. We were sailing at the time with great speed, and it happened to be a near monstrous iceberg, which to all appearances was as immovable as a rock-bound island. It seemed, however, that the iceberg had split and was breaking apart, whereupon the balance of the monster along which we were sailing was destroyed, and it began dipping from us. My father quickly anticipated the danger before I realized its awful possibilities. The iceberg extended down into the water, many hundreds of feet, and as it tipped over, the portion coming up out of the water caught our fishing craft like a lever on a fulcrum and threw it in the air as if it had been a football. Our boat fell back on the iceberg that by this time had changed its side next to us for the top. My father was still in the boat, having become entangled in the rigging, while I was thrown some 20 feet away. I quickly scrambled to my feet, shouted to my father, who answered, "All is well." Just then a realization dawned upon me, horror upon horror. The blood froze in my veins. The iceberg was still in motion, and its great weight and force in toppling over would cause it to submerge temporarily. I fully realized what a sucking maelstrom it would produce amid the worlds of water on every side. They would rush into depression in all their fury, like white-fanged wolves eager for human prey. In a supreme moment of mental anguish, I remember glancing at our boat, which was lying on its side, and wondering if it could possibly right itself, and if my father could escape. Was this the end of our struggles and adventures? Was this death? All these questions flashed through my mind in the fraction of a second, and a moment later I was entangled in a life and death struggle. The ponderous monolith of ice sank below the surface, and the frigid waters gurgled around me in a frenzied anger. I was in a saucer, with the waters pouring in on every side. A moment more, and I lost consciousness. When I partially recovered my senses and arose from the swoon of a half-drowned man, I found myself wet, stiff, and almost frozen, lying on the iceberg. There was no sign of my father or of our little fishing sloop. The monster berg had recovered itself, and with its new balance, lifted its head perhaps 50 feet above the waves. The top of this island of ice was a plateau perhaps half an acre in extent. I loved my father well and was grief-stricken at the awfulness of his death. I railed at fate that I, too, had not been permitted to sleep with him in the depths of the ocean. Frankly, I climbed to my feet and looked about me. The purple domed sky above, the shoreless green ocean beneath, and only an occasional iceberg discernible. My heart sank in hopeless despair. I cautiously picked my way across the berg toward the other side, hoping that our fishing craft had righted itself. Dared I think it possible that my father still lived? It was but a ray of hope that flamed up in my heart, but the anticipation warmed my blood in my veins and started rushing like some rare stimulant through every fiber of my body. I crept close to the precipitous side of the iceberg and peered far down, hoping, still hoping, that I made a circle of the berg. Scanning every foot of the way, I kept going around and around. One part of my brain was certainly becoming manacled, while the other part, I believe, and to this day, was perfectly rational. I was conscious of having made the circuit a dozen times, and while one part of me, intelligence knew, in all reason, there was not a vestige of hope, yet some strange, fascinating aberration bewitched and compelled me still to beguile myself with expectation. The other part of my brain seemed to tell me that while there was no possibility of my father being alive, yet, if I quit making the circuitous pilgrimage, if I paused for a single moment, it would be acknowledgement of defeat, and should I do this, I felt that I should go mad. Thus, hour after hour, I walked around and around, afraid to stop and rest, yet physically powerless to continue much longer. Oh, horror of horrors! To be cast away in this wide expanse of waters without food or drink, and only a treacherous iceberg for an abiding place. My heart sank within me, and all semblance of hope was fading into black despair. Then the hand of the deliverer was extended, and a death-like stillness of solitude rapidly became unbearable. It was suddenly broken by the firing of a signal gun. I look up in startled amazement when I saw less than a half mile away a whaling vessel bearing down toward me with her sail full set. Evidently, my continued activity on the iceberg had attracted their attention. On drawing near, they put out a boat, and descending cautiously to the water's edge, I was rescued, and a little later lifted on board the whaling ship. I found it was a Scotch whaler, the Arlington. Arlington, I just want to make note, hey, it's pretty cool. I searched for the Arlington, a Scotch whaler, the Arlington, a sailing vessel, the Arlington. And basically, I couldn't find anything. There's a modern day Navy ship, the Arlington, and there's this and that. But so if anyone could find any information about the Arlington, that'd be interesting. From back there in the late 1800s. Okay. She had cleared from Dundee in September and started immediately for the Antarctic in search of whales. The captain, Agnes McPherson, it's also a very common name, by the way, seemed kindly dispossessed, but in matters of discipline, as I soon learned, possessed of an iron will. When I attempted to tell him I had come from the inside of the earth, the captain and mate looked at each other, shook their heads, and insisted on me being put in a bunk under strict surveillance of the ship's physician. I was very weak for want of food and had not slept for many hours. However, after a few days' rest, I got up morning, dressed myself without asking permission of the physician or anyone else, and told them I was as sane as anyone. The captain sent for me and again questioned me concerning where I'd come from and how I came to be alone on an iceberg in the far-off Antarctic Ocean. So now they're in the Antarctic Ocean. Pretty wild, huh? I replied that I had just come from the inside of the earth and proceeded to tell him how my father and myself had gone in by way of Spitsbergen and come out by way of the South Pole country, whereupon I was put in irons. Yeah. I afterward heard the captain tell the mate that I was crazy as a March hare. To be as mad as a March hare is an English idiomatic phrase derived from the observed annex said to occur only in the March breeding season of the European hare. Interesting. Matt is a March hare. Learn something new. And that I must remain in confinement until I was rational enough to give a truthful account of myself. Finally, after much pleading and many promises, I was released from irons. I then and there decided to invent some story that would satisfy the captain and never again refer to my trip to the land of the Smoky God, at least until I was safe among friends. Within a fortnight, I was permitted to go about and take my place as one of the seamen. A little later, the captain asked me for an explanation. I told him that my experience had been horrible, and I was fearful of my memory, and begged him to permit me to leave the question unanswered until some time in the future. I think you are recovering considerably, he said, but you're not sane yet by a good deal. Permit me to do such work as you may assign, I replied, and if it does not compensate you sufficiently, I will pay you immediately after I reach Stockholm, to the last penny. Thus the matter rested. On finally reaching Stockholm, as I have already related, I found that my good mother had gone to her reward more than a year before. I have also told how, later, the treachery of a relative landed me in a madhouse where I remained for 28 years, seemingly unending years, and still later, after my release, how I returned to the life of a fisherman, following it sedulously for 27 years, then how I came to America, and finally to Los Angeles, California. But all this can be of little interest to the reader. Indeed, it seems to me the climax of my wonderful travels and strange adventures was reached when the Scotch sailing vessel took me from an iceberg on the Antarctic Ocean. Indeed. So we'll leave it there now. It's a short one, and we'll get into part six, the conclusion, and after that, we'll read at the same time the author's afterword, and I'll give some of my comments. It's really quite a fascinating tale, that's for sure. Very interesting. But we'll cover that in the next video. Stay tuned. Have a great day, David. Wishing you a fantastic day. Take care.